And I want to speak to the topic of raising up unique different ministries outside of the Sunday model. I'm going to talk more and more about raising up unique and different ministries outside of the Sunday morning model. And that has been my whole thrust, my whole operation. Let's see, go up higher than this. Thank you, Jesus. Raising up unique and different ministries outside of the Sunday model. And I believe God has called me in this hour of 2018 to look for anyone who's willing to serve the Lord outside of your immediate comfort zone. We have gotten comfortable in the 11 o'clock a.m. model in our body of Christ. We seem to make that the paramount day of everything. I really believe the day of the Lord is whenever the saints gather together and they're being trained and equipped for ministry regardless of what day of the week it is, whether it's a Sunday, a Saturday, a Friday, a Thursday, a Wednesday. Some folks say Sunday is the holy day. Until you speak to people who understand Jewish history and understood the Sabbath was on Saturday. And we put so much emphasis on one day out of the week, but all 7 days belong to God. So we say all 7 days.
All seven days belongs to the Lord.
And remember once? Let's keep the score high. Find the heat button and push that little high. It's low. There's a high, middle, medium button on that. Please find it for me. And so I'm a firm believer that the church is going through radical changes and that God is raising up apostolic ministries. I want you to write down two offices today. The term apostle and the term prophet, and they stand for two major G's. Apostle sets up governments, and the prophet brings forth supernatural guidance. And so when you run into these types of ministries, they think much different than normal believers, if I can use that for a title. My thinking is much more different than someone who may be what you call a normal pastor. The term pastor, Mike, is a secret title. But when you meet me, I operate more apostolic prophetically than probably most people you would ever meet, because I have the ability to see down the road and see further than what normal people will see. And everybody is not called to the ministry of the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher. As the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 4, there are some given apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastor, teachers. Now, I know English, I know the word some don't mean everybody. And so, and it doesn't mean because God called you to serve in that capacity, that makes you important than anyone. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
The person who serves as a janitor unto the Lord gets the same reward as an apostle who wins millions of souls across the nation. So we brag about the people out front, but people behind the scenes make the people out front look good. And so it's so important to understand that faithfulness is not based on title. Faithfulness is based on servanthood. Mm-hmm. And what to the capacity do you serve? Do you serve to the capacity folks can see you and clap for you and get trophies? Are you serving to the capacity because God has called you for a ministry? Someone said, God has called me to ministry.
God has called me to ministry.
I want you to understand that ministry is not based on some guy up in the pulpit with a big fat belly that goes over his belt, hush, and began to say, this is what I'm called to do. But ministry are people. Someone say people.
People.
And people who desire for the Lord to use them to serve others. I want you to write a couple of notes down. You're going to be judged in heaven on how well you perform ministry. Write that down, please. And I want you to understand that there will be a reward system. And you're going to be rewarded to how faithful you were as God delegated ministry to you, whether it was your own or whether you're serving others. God will look and judge you by the matters of the heart. Say matters of the heart. So you're going to find as God raised you up in ministry, he's always going after your heart, your motive, your tongue, your mouth, your mind. How you exalt people, how you tear people down. And as the seeds you sow out, that's the harvest that you get back. And so I've learned that when you speak well of others and lift others up, that harvest follows you. Amen, somebody. And it's so important to sow those type of seeds because one day you're going to want your own harvest, your own business, your own ministry, your own this and own that. And God will look at how you treated others. Here's a good scripture to write down, Luke chapter 16. It talks about if you cannot handle money, handle manna, you can't handle true spiritual riches. And it also talks about serving in Luke chapter 16. It talks about the prodigal son. There's so much that has to do with serving good and how you handle the resources God has given you. Say, Lord God, teach me.
Lord God, teach me.
Hello, Dougie Vaughn. Hello, Crystal President. Hello, Reverend David Rowley. Amen. That's right, David Rowley. Amen to Omolu, God bless you. Keela, amen, God bless you. Tell Pastor Tim and Linda, we said hi. I want to go to John chapter 5, and the name of my title is Raising Up Unique and Different Ministries Besides the Sunday Morning Model. That's my title. And I'm going to continue to tell you that the greatest ministries to come are going to be located inside of teenagers. Hear me closely. The greatest ministry to come will be inside of young ladies like yourself who will be below their 30 years young model. That number 18 through 33, those are strategic years in your life. Trust me, as all years are. But something about that age 30, 31, 32, 33 are very important. And if you are below the age of 30, you are blessed to be in front of you. Now, not that everyone's not blessed, but there's something about 30, 31, 32, 33 that's very important in biblical order. Jesus Christ spent 3.5 years of full-time ministry. He prepared for 29 years, and then the anointing fell on him publicly when he was announced that he was the Messiah. And from 30 to 33 and a half, he did 3.5 years, finished his course, caught up to heaven, and now seated at the right hand of the Father. And based on how effective this ministry was, you're saved and sitting here today. And that was over close to 2,000 years ago. And so I come to find out, God is looking at your faithfulness, your consistency, your persistence. And trust me, when time comes for rewards and trophies and celebration, God will look at all of you and see how faithful you were. And that's what some folks don't understand. God don't give folks rewards because they chase crowds or because they chase a successful model. God rewards faithfulness. God rewards consistency. God rewards someone that understands the power of covenant. Someone says covenant. I'm actually training some of you who are single for marriage. Because you're going to understand you honor your covenant, it proves you can stick with something long enough, even if it's not comfortable, even when it's not what you thought of, even if it's not the plan that you chose. But how many of you know that when you start working with God, God always does something with you you don't always agree with? Come on, say it to somebody. And you're going to learn, you're going to start quoting the things that Jesus Christ quoted, which was this: not my will be done, but your will be done. Not my plan be done, but your plan be done. Jesus Christ prayed that prayer 3 times before the crucifixion. And what he really was saying, he was saying to God the Father, as powerful as you are, as mighty as you are, you mean to tell me the only way to redeem man is through a cross? You can't think of nothing else? You got another plan here? You mean I got to die on a rugged cross and be separated from you? You mean this is the plan you got for me? And that's what we do. We look around and say, God, this is the plan? This is the journey. This is the goal, God. This can't be it. Yes, it is. Because God has a way of training and equipping people more differently than you expect. God bless you, Tanya Gray. God bless you, Crystal. So in John chapter 5, I'm going to look at a style of ministry that I believe that KOM is in the middle of. And where God has allowed our leadership in the city of Patterson to do historical things. And I mention things over and over to remind you of the historical setting that's taking place in the city of Patterson because of the leadership of this ministry. And even though people may not honor you for it, God honors you. And you're going to learn that when you start doing stuff, when you start operating the way God wants you to operate, you're going to read Mark's program with a huge fan. You're going to realize that God rewards faithfulness. God rewards perseverance. God rewards a mental mindset of, hey, these folks really believe, they really trust me, and they stick with me. And because we live in a society that always looks at numbers and looks at other successful models, we tend to reduplicate what God already did. And sometimes God wants you to have your own fingerprint. Some say my own fingerprint. Mm-hmm. And that means that God is going to raise you up uniquely. He's going to use your personality. He's going to use your story. He's going to use your experience. He's going to use your car accident. He's going to use you almost being homeless. He's going to use you, your situation you came through with your background in your home and some of the things you did that were negative. He's going to use people judging you. He's going to use your past. And he's going to use it for ministry, not for condemnation, not for judgment, not for someone to say they're bigger than you and better than you, but he's going to expose you. He's going to raise you up in such a unique way that people are going to be surprised at how God raised you up. Nothing's more powerful than to be raised up to successful levels, and the system can explain how you got there. That's the thing that blows people away. Now, I'm going to tell you something about books, Marvel comic books, DC, movies, Star Wars. These are people who decided to step out and do something historically, strategically, and differently than anybody else. And this is where you get your billionaires from, your successful models, and even those who are who win the world's goods and their soul end up in hell. At least you can learn from the principles of how they acquire these world's goods. That means someone has to come across and do something that's more unique than the next person. And it doesn't mean you're trying to make yourself better, but God is trying to show you that I can use you the way I need to use you. And you have to become comfortable in your skin. Someone say, I have to learn to become comfortable.
I have to learn to become comfortable.
In my skin.
In my skin.
All right? Usually when you're not comfortable with your skin, you're trying to jump in someone else's.
Oh, yeah.
And so what you want to do is be comfortable with who God called you to be. All right? If God gave you dark skin, don't try to get an operation to make it light skin. Amen, somebody. If God made you short, stop poking, I wish I was taller. It's because we never satisfy to who God called us to be. I'm going to give you some things to really make you think about it. God did not make you for you. God made you for himself. And that's deep right there. That's real deep. As a matter of fact, God puts it like this. He placed certain members in the body that pleases him. Somebody say pleases him. So when he set you up, when he made you up, when he created you, God did this. Oh, Lisa. Oh, Sean. Oh, Bree. And he looked at you and he studied you. Oh, he looked over at Jesus and said, I made that. That's
yes.
My
blah,
blah.
Yes.
And everything about you made God get so excited.
Yes.
And we didn't only want to get in the mirror.
Come on.
And tell God how ugly I look. I don't like my nose. I don't like my lips. I don't like my eyes. And everything God gave you made him say, it is good. So you have to practice 2018, get in the mirror and say, I am God's gift to the world.
Yes.
I am good. You got to start saying it. You got to
yes.
say it. And you can't allow the opinions of others to make you feel any less than that. God bless you, Robert. God bless you, Tiffany. God bless you, Pastor Shannon. And if you don't learn to do that, you have to become your number one cheerleader. You have to get in the mirror. And this is Sean. Let's agree. You get in that mirror. You got to say, I am who God called me to be.
Right.
And speak to yourself. And tell yourself, I am who God called me to be. And don't allow yourself to get into the market of comparison. And that's when we start finding out what we consider to be successful, looking at another man's model. I like to look at things like this. God, what can I do that sets me aside from everybody else?
Yes.
I like to think of things like if I'm 7 million people and I'm the only one with these fingerprints, then there's something God gave me breath to do that only I can do and the capacity that I can do it. Amen, somebody. When you start thinking like this, it changes your focus and it changes your eyes and it changes how you perceive and think things. John chapter 5, I actually created my church for John chapter 5, which I reference, I call that the manual for sonship. Say sonship.
Sonship.
Come on, say sonship.
Sonship.
It's very important to understand. If you operate in sonship, you get things at the table that the other workers do not get. I'll try one more time. Sonship means the father shares things with the family he doesn't share with strangers or with workers. And don't confuse yourself. If you are an owner of a corporation, at the end of the day, no one gets in the between your sons and your daughters. Now, you can play it off all you want. If you own McDonald's, trust me, that father is looking to share his assets with his immediate family first. Even if the son is an idiot or the daughter is crazy, at the end of the day, that father and mother is saying, how can I get my kids ready to inherit what I have? This is very important to understand it. So when I speak of sonship, I'm saying that God wants you to sit at the table so he can show you how to move, how to allow him to use you. And when you understand that God is using you, the opinions of others don't matter.
Amen.
See, most of us do things for the opinion of others and how folks look at us. And so they're really controlling you and manipulating you. But once you understand what God's giving you breath to do, it gives you a new lease on life. I get up saying, Lord God, I'm grateful to get up today. I get up in the morning, Reverend Mark, and I stand up and say, God, I'm so glad I'm still alive. And Lord God, thank you for my place. I thank you for my job. Three of them, amen, somebody. I thank you, Lord God, for establishing me in the marketplace. Lord God, I'm so grateful. And I start thanking God that everything he's blessed me with just in the last 3 days. You can spend an hour just giving God thanks for what he did in the last 24 hours. If you think about it, everything he's done. And I practice having a heart full of thanks. Say a heart full of thanks.
Heart full of thanks.
Keep in mind, God works the kingdom according to the heart. Write that down. God works the kingdom according to the heart, not according to your position. He works it according to your what? Heart. Say heart. Everybody say heart.
Heart,
heart is spelled H-E-A-R-T. Right? You got that? And inside of heart is the word what? Art. And the word what? ear. And the word what? Hear. So how you hear it, how you ear it, and how you draw it will determine how your insides change. So if you draw images of defeat, you draw images of bitterness, you draw images of, I wasn't treated right, they did me wrong, I don't like this, that will show up in your heart, and that will determine the type of God, watch this, that will perform miracles exceedingly, abundantly, above more that you ask, think, dream, or imagine. Now this is why I can believe God, I'm talking personal now, I can step out on the water and perform mighty works and folks still scratching their head trying to figure out how do I do what I do. Because in my heart, I hold no bitterness. Listen to me. Mm-hmm. In my heart, I'm quick to forgive. In my heart, I try to always stay professional at all times. Yay. In my heart, I try to limit talking ugly about people. I say limit because sometimes I get mad too. But in my heart, I'm always asking, I keep my heart right so that when God starts to move and to perform, he operates according to the power that works within you.
Yes.
This is very important. Yes. See, we quote that scripture to the God that is exceedingly, abundantly, above more than the aspirin, dream, or imagine. But it don't stop there. According to the power that works in you. So God is not short on power, Sean. God's not short on power, Reverend Marcus. God is short on what is going on inside your heart.
Yes.
So really, meditation, prayer, worship, sticking with God creates a heart that causes God to do this. I have rejected David's brothers, but I chose David to knock out giants because David's heart is perfect towards me. That's deep. That means your outside actions could be off sometimes, but your heart believes God so well, God will bless you because of your heart and not because your outside actions are always correct. That's why it's hard to judge people, to say who's saved, who not saved, who going to heaven, who going to hell. That's not your call. It's not your call. All you can do is give people the word and allow them to work out their salvation according to their what? Their heart. Mm-hmm. So what God does, any closing, when God really starts to disciple you, he goes after the matters of the what? Heart. So these are issues that the church have to deal with. How long it takes you to forgive.
Yeah.
How long you hold on to bitterness.
Yeah.
Do you have an attitude with God? Mm-hmm. Show you something. Do you hold grudges long? Mm-hmm. Do you tend to judge others on their actions and judge yourself on your intentions? See? Mm-hmm. See, and what God does, he always allows you to look at your heart. So your heart will determine the type of God that will work on your behalf. To the God that will do exceedingly, abundantly, above more than I can ask, think, dream, or imagine, Amplified Bible, according to the power that works in me. That's why worship, praise, and prayer will help reform, reshape the heart, so God will look at your heart and perform stuff for you that makes no sense. It makes no sense. It's deep. I'm show you. So I'm going to show you in John chapter 5, why John chapter 5 is the chapter that challenges traditional thinking. Say traditional thinking.
Traditional.
And one of the enemies of the traditional church are the traditions. Now, I don't mind honoring traditions as long as you don't restrict God to the traditions. I don't mind traditions as long as you don't judge others who come untraditionally. See, it's because there was a tradition. The Jews thought God only belonged to them. And they thought God was only after two things, the city of Jerusalem and the state of Israel. All God wanted was Canaan and the city of Jerusalem. That's all he was concerned about. And we are God's chosen people. That was their tradition. But as God began to move through history, biblical history, he was preparing Israel to be the worldwide evangelists so they can reach other nations who were not born in the natural seed of the Jews. But because it was self-centered, they thought it was just about them. So in 70 AD, God closed down the whole Jewish system and began the kingdom of God, which included Jews and Gentiles. They become one. So it's not the blood you born physically, it's the blood you accept spiritually. Woo! Teach this thing. And so when you understand this man, it brings you to the family. How many saw the picture that Tyler Perry wrote where these two girls were on a road trip? And remember that picture? This white lady, she owned the company. She took the black lady on the road trip. They was traveling around. And the other guy was trying to open up a construction company. I've got someone was coming out on Facebook here.
Oh, the family that prays.
Ah, the family that prays. What a dynamic picture that shows you the two sisters were fighting against each other. Mm-hmm. And the white lady had a company. She was dying. And the son thought he was going to take over. And they found this guy. There was drugs. Come to find out, he was once a smart guy on Wall Street, but drugs took him off. They cleaned him up, sat him at the table, and made him part of the owner of the company. Which God will look amongst mess and make masterpieces.
Yes,
God will look among people that folk overlook and set you at the table and say, I will do exceedingly, abundantly, above more that you ask, think, dream, or imagine. And when you are raised up untraditionally, the traditions cannot bind you. See if a group can promote you and make you feel like someone, they will restrict you to the limitation. But when God lifts you up and raises you up some other way that is different than what they used to, they no longer control you. Say, Lord God, raise me up.
Lord God, raise me up.
Come on, say this. Say, Lord God, raise me up.
Lord God, raise me up.
So I'm trying to show you this principle, and the principle is this: there is an untraditional, radical group of ministers that are on their way that we, the church, must be able to train them. Notice how I say train them. Say train them.
Train them.
Now, let me just talk about some things. I need to talk in terms of what's going on presently. So, Elder Lisa goes to 23rd Street and 10th Ave, and she opens up her ministry at the corner. And about 15, 20 women show up who are so excited about what she did. And the Lord said, the more you raise a minister like that, McDuffie, the more you operate apostolically. He said, time will be when you would not be able to see everybody, and all the spiritual sons and daughters you raise up, the people will look for them and not look for you. See, that's the true ministry. It's not you up front. It's how many folks you put up front. How many folks you push to levels? And that's what I'm doing with Tawan and Micaiah, my wife Jamie, and Linda, and Shine, and Marcus, and Elisa, and Bree, and Sean. The faster I get you into movement, say movement. Come and say movement. And mobilization, the faster evangelism goes. Let me give you some statistical laws again. This is very important to understand that. Everybody in this room can reach 8 to 12 people where other folks cannot.
Yeah.
You have a sphere of 8 to 12 that only you can reach. And if no one ever trained you how to reach them, you will miss the opportunity of evangelism. Now, if you look around, look at your job, look at your circle of friends, look at the folks you hang out with. The question is, how much of the kingdom have you shared with your circle? Now, either you're ashamed of Jesus, you want to talk about him, but God will send you people who are waiting for Jesus, and until you start talking about him, they'll never receive him. I've been working every day. I'm around teachers, I'm around students, I'm around certain people, and I realize something. Some folks want to hear Jesus from you and not from anybody else. Mm-hmm. Now you say, go see this person, go see that person, go see Pastor Mike, and God says, no, they don't have to go see Pastor Mike. They need just to see who? You. Say you.
You.
Come on, say you. Tap your chest and say, I am called to ministry. Come on, tap your chest and say, I am called to ministry. Say, I am a minister. That's hard to say, y'all. Say, I am a minister. And I'm using the term minister in terms of servanthood, in terms of understanding that everybody is called to do something. Say something. And everybody's not called to this. We think this is like the cream of the crop, and we got to reach this. God is called to you to reach a specific people. And I can touch folks all day long and prophesy, and God said, I don't want you touching them. I need Bree to touch her.
That's right.
I need Kaya to touch that. I need Jaden to touch. See, if I don't get you in the mindset, I said y'all, a mobilization movement, I fail as an apostle. So my job is to make you mad at me. That's a job. My job is to make sure I'm not this friendly guy you like. Because I fail as a leader. My job is to make you say, dang, I can't stand that guy, but I gotta do what he said. He made me sick, but he pushing. Because my job is to push you, just like you're supposed to push me. That's the job of the church. We don't like to sharpen skills. And so I thought about how strategic God is, and what's going on historically in the school district because of the ministry leadership of you people, from the IM Initiative to Pillar College, Hohokus Trade School, to the Pathway to Effective Education, to the school district getting local control, to the building in transition, to becoming the first building about to do a faith-based project to change the whole fourth ward, to the city council and then a new board president of the education who is expecting this major project. You're going to set the tone for things to come. The Pillar College about to buy a building and put their own four-year campus here. We soon we have our own football team, baseball, all because somebody thought outside the box. Because I had restricted myself to the 11 o'clock motto in church inside of four walls, I will not be on the brink of history. Trust me, your kids will run about me one day.
Amen.
I'm gonna be on someone's wall. I'm gonna be in someone's history book. Remember that Vernon McDuffie guy? He was so broke, he always had like he had everything. Remember that when he was struggling and then no one helped him and then God sent him to Jesus? And they will write about you, and this is what happens when you study history. At first, you are the enemy. At first, you're the enemy of the state. You're the worst thing. But after you survive, after you pass your baton, your kids brag about you. Your nieces, your nephews will say, remember Lisa, remember Jamie, remember Linda, remember how she was living but still made it to church every single Sunday. See, yeah. Your testimony proves it can be done untraditionally.
Yeah,
it's key. That's so key, man. That is so key. I was reading the history of Stan Lee, who's 95 years old, who's really the founder and producer of Marvel Comics.
Mm-hmm.
And one time, Marvel Comics was on its way out because they were reaching a deficit. But his wife ministered to Stan Lee. His wife helped him.
Wow.
Told him to expand the storyline, change the characters, give them flaws, and let them know they suffered like everybody else.
Wow.
And when they made that change, the Marvel stopped it up. See, one person can speak something to change the course of a company. And Marvel sold to Disney for $4 billion. And by the end of those daggone Iron Man movies, they flipped it and made another $4 billion. So $8 billion off the $4 billion, and how many Stan Lee live and pray this morning?
Yeah,
95 years old. Why? Because he did something quite untraditional. Well, Pastor Mike, those are just comments. They're more than comments. Anytime you make $8 billion, they're more than comments. Those are jobs, those are corporations, that's your kids' college fund. Whoever works for Marvel works for Disney.
You got that?
Amen.
That's a parable.
See, I'm trying to show you. See, if I can get the church to stop thinking of the 11 o'clock a.m. model and start thinking of people as the church, lost souls waiting for you to show up, and thinking strategic, thinking outside the norm. And I realize I'm a tough cookie to bite into. I'm rough to drink sometimes because the traditional churches get folks to come together, pay the church tithes and offerings, and folks live off of tithes and offerings. The only problem is with the problem is this, is that a lot of what we ask folks to do in our communities, they don't have jobs.
Mm-hmm.
And the job you have is not paying your bills.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm going to pay tithes versus paying my rent, trust me, I'm paying rent. Turn around, I'm paying rent.
Yeah.
And you have to suffer. I'm not going to be homeless.
Yeah,
I'm going to pay
all
that. I'm going to pay. And so,
right.
So I realized that tithing often in this season is not key.
It's
now, I still require you to do it. You want to walk with Christ, it's up to you. But I'm telling you right now that that's not why I depend for God to take care of me.
That's right.
Because there's wealth inside one Pharaoh that will pay my life for the next four lives. There's wealth inside of a rock that will raise you up if you understand ministry that's raised untraditionally.
Yes.
So my job is to raise up untraditional ministers and drop the kingdom inside of circles that never expected you to fall into. Now, I want to go to John 5. Look at this. I'll be preaching twice today because church 11, Pastor 11 is 6. I'm doing church 11 service too. So we got ministry all day today. John 5, watch this. So I'm going to say sonship.
Are the sons
that God would raise up.
That
will move forward.
Untraditionally.
Uniquely.
But
with great gifts.
Anyone
who is a mindset, a mature person, can honor others.
Yes.
If you have a problem honoring others, that means you don't honor yourself.
That's right.
And this is what I've actually learned to do. When I see someone that has a gift that is not my gift, I go out of my way to celebrate it.
That's right.
Because it takes the attention off myself and put it on someone else.
Yes.
You know this principle, Sean. You see someone that can draw, someone that can sing, someone that can dance, someone that can work out, someone that has the ability to organize and keep things on. I find little stuff and I just brag about it. You know, so even, you're not bragging on my wife a lot of time. I talk about her body. You know, I'll go past her and slap her on the shoulder. And able to brag about stuff. Because well, I'm learning that when you don't learn the outer people, the attention stays on yourself.
Yeah.
One guy came up and said, Pastor, I heard about you went to college. I've been to college yet. I've been to college. I'm with me. That was Dominic. That was Reverend Marcus. That was Elder Lisa. That was my family. That was my church. That was my people. They bought it here. I just want a piece of the puzzle. That's not me. Not me. And every time you try to get it on me, I push it off because when you honor
yes,
right. I brag about it. Dominic, my Italian brother. If without Dominic, there'll be no Pillar College. I said, Dominic is the new president of the Patterson campus. Dominic said, Pastor, I'm not the president. Oh, yeah, you will be. And everything I say starts to come to pass. Learn to honor others.
That's it.
And God will pour honor on you. One thing I like about Micaiah, Micaiah can sing her behind off, but then she see other folks sing, she'll say, they can sing better. She do all the time. She said, you know how well you sing? Do you know how gifted you are? She knows it. But she's never afraid to know you can do it. She's not looking for the limelight to be up front. But then that works in reverse sometimes. Because I got to push her up front. I got to push her. Same thing with Tuan. Tuan is the type of guy, smart kid, know all the sports. I honor him so much, but he has the ability to talk about other folks' giftings. He got, Tuan, you got so much going here, but it's not just about me. When you got that kind of spirit on you like that, man, you're going to be raised untraditionally. Mm-hmm. And God's going to put you in strategic position in places where you can minister to other people where the traditional folks cannot.
Can we try?
Can we? John 5, watch this. Sometime later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Say Jerusalem. Come on, say Jerusalem. Come on, say Jerusalem. This is the holy city. This is the chosen city. This is the one that the Jews felt was theirs and God belonged to them. And that was it. That was their city. Say Jerusalem. For a feast of the Jews. Say feast. Come on, y'all say feast. It means party. Now there in Jerusalem, near the sheep gate, a pool, which in Aramaic is called Bethesda. Say Bethesda.
Bethesda.
Which is surrounded by five covered porches. But at this pool, say at this pool, were a bunch of disabled people.
Yeah.
Disabled, all right? Now, they got the ability, but it's been disabled, which means disconnected.
Yeah,
all right, they got the potential, but now it's impotent. Something is shutting it down. Something is not allowing them to operate at the mark they're supposed to. Can I give you another meaning of the word sin? Mm-hmm. To miss the original assignment you're supposed to walk in. Mm. To fall beneath what God called you to walk on top of. Mm. That's what sin really is. Not just breaking up a law. It means God created you here, but you operate here. Mm-hmm. Look at me, y'all. Look at me, Kai. God created you to be like this, but you decide to be like this. See, this is very important to understand. So sin is much more than just not fornicating or fornicating.
Right.
I have a sex sentence.
Right.